Welcome to the 4th Congressional District Candidates Forum, sponsored by the Stillwater Gazette. My name is Marguerite Reinberger, also known as Margot. In alphabetical order, the three candidates running for this office are DFL-endorsed Betty McCollum, Republican-endorsed Greg Ryan, and Legal Marijuana Now-endorsed Susan Pendergast-Sint. Jonathan Young, the managing editor of the Stillwater Gazette, will be writing up your responses, and they'll appear in this Friday, October 7th edition. During this 60-minute forum, each candidate will be invited to give up to a 1.5-minute opening, a 1.5-minute closing, and up to 1.5 minutes will be allotted to answer questions. A 1-minute rebuttal will be allowed if your opponent refers to you directly or indirectly in his or her response, and I may offer it or you may request it, and I have the final decision on whether to allow it. Paige Johnson will be the timekeeper. We're going to be very strict in our timing. She'll hold up cards that say 1 minute, 30 seconds, 15 seconds, and stop. When you see the stop card, at the same time Paige yells, stop, that is the end of your time, so plan it accordingly. There won't be any conjunctions this year. The Stillwater Gazette has provided the questions I'll ask in order to avoid any potential setup bias for or against a candidate, as too often happens when questions are solicited. However, candidates, I please ask that you make yourself available to your constituents if there are questions that I won't be able to ask, but that are important to their decision-making, and I'm sure there are going to be many, many. Please save your applause for the end and refrain from making any noise, including whispering, because we can pick that up here. Now, the order of who talks first and last is going to be determined by a system that I use, reverse alphabetical order, which that's just normal of how I do it, and it means that Susan Sint will do the opening first. She'll be the first to answer the first question, and we'll do the closing last. So, it might look unusual to you, but this is how it's going to go. Susan, Betty, Greg, then Betty, Greg, Susan, and Greg, Susan, Betty. Just go with it. It works, and everyone gets their time in place. So, let's begin opening statements with Susan Sint.
Hello. So, I'm running for the Legal Marijuana Now Party. I guess you can all figure out I want to legalize marijuana. You know, I'm not a politician. I'm doing this because I believe our leaders are not really paying attention to the change in public opinion. Cannabis is medicine. Hemp is an industrial product. They can be useful for our environment. Most importantly, a prohibition law is an absolute infringement on personal liberty. And that is the principle that America is based on, personal freedom. That is the point. When you take a behavior and say that it's a crime, there needs to be victims. With marijuana consumption, there are no victims. Marijuana prohibition is the crime. That's where the victims are. If I get voted into office, I would work diligently to pass H.R. 1013. We need to recognize the right for consumers to cultivate and consume marijuana for their own personal use. We've got to erase past marijuana convictions and abolish employment drug testing.
Thank you. Betty McCollum.
Thank you. Good evening. Well, I'm Betty McCollum, and I want to thank the Stillwater Gazette for hosting this forum tonight. I think most of us can agree that our nation's politics has become too mean-spirited and at times just too ugly. American people deserve better. We need more civility and common decency in our politics and in Congress as well. In Congress, the constant obstruction and gridlock prevents compromise and it prevents common sense solutions from advancing. That hurts families, it hurts our economy, and it's hurting our nation. I'm running for re-election because I want to work to bring people together, Democrats, Republicans, and Independents, to help solve the really big challenges facing our country today. We need to build a bigger, stronger, better America. We need Washington to work to ensure stability and predictability for our economy and for our families. We don't need gridlock. We do not need obstructionism. I'm committed to working with both sides of the aisle to reinvest and rebuild our crumbling public infrastructure. We need to find common ground, and we need to fix our broken immigration system. I want to make sure that we have an economy that works for everyone. In this election, I'm working to earn your support. Thank you.
Thank you. Greg Ryan.
My name is Greg Ryan. I am a 32-year business owner of a plumbing and heating company in St. Paul. My grandfather started in 1951. He was a plumber, and his father was also a plumber. He was he helped put plumbing in at the state capitol in 1904-05 when they built the state capitol. He was a state legislator in 1919-1920. My grandfather was a legislator in 1966 through 74. My father took over the business in 1966 when my grandfather was doing politics, and he had the business ownership until 1984 when he was tragically shot and killed by a burglar holdup at our plumbing store, which is still there today at 811 University Avenue. I've been the owner and operator along with my brothers for the last 30 years, and I've just been 32 years, and I've just been taking the pulse of the 4th District, and we are really disappointed with the action and inaction of what Congress has been doing to suffocate us citizens in this 4th District. And they just continue to do this never-ending suffocation and making it harder and harder for us citizens to conduct business, to go into business, and just to be friendly citizens of this 4th District.
Okay, I'll begin the first question with Susan. Racial tensions seem to be mounting in the country, especially in relation to police use of force. What can or should the federal government do about this problem?
I believe that we need to provide de-escalation training for our police officers. I worked as an educator in our schools, and it is a very complicated situation trying to regulate people's behavior. And we need to look for peaceful remedies. And I believe that we need to de-escalate situations. Our police officers need training in how to deal with difficult situations other than resorting to violence.
Thank you. Betty.
Thank you for that question, because it certainly has been on the mind of many people, and I know it's been discussions that have taken place in communities all across this country, but with the tragedy that happened in Ramsey County, it's been a conversation that's been very, very close to home. We need to have more training. De-escalation is important, but also we need to look at municipalities and local government to ask them to review, and that's currently going on right now. The state of Minnesota asked to review to see what was happening with police stops, what could be done better, and what we can do to protect public safety, but also make sure that the public knows that when they're pulled over that they're going to be safe. Body cameras is one of the solutions. The federal government's looking at working on that and helping local units of government be able to have those available to them if they would like to use them. State of Minnesota is currently working on laws and reviewing to protect everyone's privacy in the use of those. But mental illness is something that we're seeing really driving a lot of the situations that our police officers finding themselves in. And we need to do a better job as a community of helping those individuals with mental illness and helping our police officers when dealing with them.
Thank you. And Greg Ryan.
In the last 8 years, we've seen an increase of the meddling of our Justice Department into the local police. And that's been, in the last 8 years, I've really recognized the elevation of conflict between us citizens and the police officers, and I do believe it's because of the overreaching of the Justice Department and their meddling in the affairs of our local police departments. We need to let the police departments work on their own and do what they have been doing for years and years and years in their effectiveness of crime stopping. I think that since we've introduced a lot of the Obama administration has been meddling in a lot of our police departments and telling the police departments what to do, what not to do, because of the federal monies that is sent over. They are always attached to different mandates that they have to do in order to get the money that they receive. So I believe that we need to let these police, you've got about 99% of police departments do the good thing, do the right job. You're always going to get a couple of rogue police officers that don't do the right thing, and I think that we're focusing way too much on that. And litigation has just gone out of control with police department not, doing a very good job and then encouraging citizens to sue the police department.
I'll begin the next question with Betty. It has been widely reported that the national debt is approaching $20 trillion. What suggestions do you have to address this with the intent of lowering it?
Our national debt is something that you hear people talk about a lot, but I just want to go back and just take a quick course in history. In 16 years ago, when I was first running for Congress in 2000, we were hearing from people that, we weren't going to have any debt, and what were we going to do in our future? And one of the discussions was, well, let's lock the Social Security lockbox and make sure that our seniors can feel that they can retire in dignity. And the first thing that happened after I got to Washington was, let's pass tax cuts. And the tax cuts were passed, and they were supposed to stimulate our economy and bring more dollars into our economy. Total failure of them to do that. And then something else happened. Our nation befell tragedy with the attacks in New York on 9/11 and what happened at the Pentagon and the plane that went down in Pennsylvania. And we went to war in Afghanistan. But when we went to war putting everything on a credit card. And that was wrong. And so what we need to do is we need to be reinvesting and re-stimulating our economy with workforce opportunities for our workers and with infrastructure for roads, bridges, rebuilding our electric grid. It goes on and on and on. It'll make America stronger and at the same time put America back to work.
Thank you. Greg.
The debt. Well, when Betty took office, it was at about $4 trillion. It's close to $20 trillion now, so we can blame her in the Congress for that. I don't think that war and 9/11 costed us, $14 trillion. It's the burgeoning of our government agencies and the growth of our government agencies and the lack of Congress's ability to say, stop, we're not going to grow this budget anymore. These departments are more or less tenured. If you're a government employee, you're tenured. You can't get fired. You can't lose your job. And their budgets keep growing year after year after year. When is the last time we've heard that a Department of Education reduced its actual spending per cycle? That just never happens. And then it's Congress's inability to get a balanced budget for the fiscal year. They keep doing this continuing resolution. And it's just lack of their leadership and just not doing their job. It's dereliction of Congress, and they're just not doing their job. They need to get a good budget. They keep kicking the can down the road, and they keep saying, oh, let's just work on last year's budget with a little bit of increases that they've had. And then we'll just sign that as a budget resolution. I just can't understand why they continue to do it, and then they ask for another 2 years representing us.
Stop.
People.
Remember, watch the timing. Strict enforcement. Okay, I'd like to offer Betty McCollum a minute rebuttal. She'd like
just very quick. I'm in the minority. The Republicans have the largest majority that they've had in the history. They failed to be able to bring a budget to the floor and pass it. And we need to work together on these issues to solve it, because on that I will agree, Congress needs to do their job. If you want to be the party in charge, you have the ability to move a budget forward. You have the ability to make these changes, and they should step up and do it. Instead, we voted on a continuing resolution, and that's not the way to move America forward. We need to stop the gridlock, and we need to have more predictability in our economy, and that's what I'm going to work for.
Susan, same question.
I believe that our rising debt is most likely due to unnecessary wars, large tax cuts for large corporations. I believe it is essential that we keep the federal benefit programs, Medicare, Medicaid, solvent, available for everyone. Social Security should be able to take care of itself. Perhaps if we raise the income deduction cap, as Bernie Sanders suggested, to keep it solvent. Again, I think that the bigger problem is the military budget and the amount of money that we spend on unnecessary wars, when we should be reinvesting money into local communities and into schools and healthcare, so we have a healthy, educated population focusing on peace instead of war.
Thank you. I'll begin the next question with Greg. Fear of terrorism is top in the minds of many people. Is the U.S. utilizing too much of our own financial and human resources to fill the role as the world peacekeeper? And should it instead use more of these resources in keeping us protected in our own country? Is there some balance that can be made between the two?
Terrorism, is that a question?
If you'd like to answer it.
Well, with terrorists, we've seen nothing but growth in terrorism activity since we pulled out of Afghanistan, and it's just been growing by leaps and bounds. We're getting hit in our homeland by terrorists, and this is just, it's a shame that we have people that supported the withdrawal of all the troops and supported President Obama to remove ourselves from these foreign nations that are havens for terrorists. Now they're infiltrating all over the globe and in the U.S., and to rid us of that, we need to get rid of the existing, well, the president is going now, but we need to get a better leader in there that's going to lead with strength. So the terrorists look at the United States and say, we don't want to mess with those people, and have a strong Congress that's going to be extremely hard on anybody that commits any crimes. Also, the immigration law is a mess. We're not enforcing the immigration law. We're bringing in all kinds of refugees that we can't even vet right now. So we need to put a stop to that and find out what is wrong with these people, and you know, who's making these decisions to create havoc with us.
Thank you. Susan.
I believe very strongly that we need to defend our country. I believe in defense, and I think that we need to think very carefully before we enter another country and get involved in their war. I believe that we need to focus on peace. We need to find diplomatic solutions focused on peace talks. And if we're going to talk about terrorism, then we need to think carefully about everybody in this world. We do need to consider Ukrainian independence, and we should help protect Eastern European nations from Soviet invasion and terrorism, not just the Middle East. And I feel that if we step in there and get involved in wars, we simply just make the problem worse. The war just creates more war, and we need to start focusing on peace.
Thank you, Betty.
Well, the war in Afghanistan was one that was prompted by the attacks on the soil of the United States, and I voted for that war. But as we were working with other nations around the world to bring stability to Afghanistan, there was another vote on the House floor, and that was to go to war in Iraq. I voted against that. There was no need to do that, and we've been living with the consequences of that war ever since. The Middle East is just a hot spot that fills our news all the time. But what's going on with the proliferation of terrorism and ISIL is not the United States alone that needs to work on that. We need to continue working with our NATO partners and other partners around the world to root out these terrorists that are, it's not just in the United States, we see what's happening in Europe too. So we need to have good partners. But we need to think smartly about how we work with other nations. And I don't believe that we should put any more troops on the ground in Iraq and in Syria. When we left Iraq because the Iraqi government could not get its act together and have a contract with the United States on an understanding to protect our troops when they were over there. So we had to leave. So Iraq doesn't have a government in which you can work with. Syria is a place where we need to work with other nations to contain and hold and defeat ISIL.
Thank you. And I'll begin the next question with Susan. Under the Affordable Care Act, also known as Obamacare, more people now have health insurance than before. However, there are still concerns about affordability, and some insurance companies are pulling out of exchanges such as Mensure. What changes, if any, would you make to address the ongoing issues with the Affordable Care Act?
I believe that we should abolish the Affordable Care Act, but only after we have created a single-payer system. I believe that we should have Medicare and Medicaid for all. I believe that what is significant is our government has got to maintain the ability to negotiate prices with the pharmaceutical manufacturers. We need control of the prices and make health care available and affordable for everyone.
Thank you. Betty?
Well, the Affordable Care Act, as you stated, has provided insurance for tens of millions of people all across the United States. People no longer have to worry about whether or not they'll have a diagnosis of breast cancer and not have access to insurance. Parents don't worry about a child that might have been born with a birth defect, never being able to, you know, live up to his or her full potential because of the weight of not being able to have insurance available. So it's done many, many good things. And there's some challenges within the Affordable Care Act. They've been identified. But rather than fix those challenges and come together for what is in the best interest of the American people, we have seen 60 votes on the House floor to just repeal the entire Affordable Care Act. We know that there's things in there that we can work on, that we can improve to make it work even better for the American public. But the leadership in the House of Representatives has failed to bring one of those ideas forward where we can all work on it together.
Thank you. Greg.
You can keep your doctor and it'll cost you $2,500 less. What a lie about the Affordable Care Act. This is devastating to the 4th Congressional District, especially in the area that I work down in St. Paul. It's just incredible the amount of people I talk to that say, well, it's a difference between me making a mortgage payment or me paying my health insurance. You know what? I'm going to drop my health insurance. It goes up, it goes up, and it goes up. Unless you're gifted and you get subsidized and you don't make enough money to earn a living and pay health care, you will get subsidized for it. But it's just a mess. And we only had, when we had the Congress was Senate, House, and the presidency, that's the only way it got passed. They shoved it down our throat, a la John Gruber. He basically said, you need to fool the American public, and then we can pass it. Nancy Pelosi said, go ahead, we got to pass it before we can read it. 2,700 pages. You know, if I'm going to have a bill that's more than 5 pages, I'll say, no, I'm not going to sign it. It's got to be simple. It's got to be something that everybody can understand. You know, this Affordable Care Act is really, really devastating the 4th District right now. There might be a few extra people that are benefiting from it, but what I'm seeing and experiencing is it's devastating.
I'll begin the next question with Betty. A slow economic recovery has left many Americans underemployed and with little in savings. Evaluate the federal government's approach to the economy in recent years. What should the government's role be in the ongoing economic recovery?
When we were going through the Great Recession, almost fell into a recession, that mirrored the Depression. We found a way to come together as Americans, and that was the Reinvest and Recovery Act. It put millions of Americans to work. In the 4th Congressional District, one of the projects that it helped fund was the construction work at the Union Depot, and other projects, other bridges, roads, infrastructure all across this country. And those people, when they went to work, brought money back home into their communities and it stimulated our economy. Just think of all the roads, bridges, and infrastructure. Just think of Flint, Michigan, and all the work that's out there for us to do together and at the same time stimulate our economy. So I'm ready to reinvest. I'm ready to rebuild. and it will pay dividends not only for today's generation by putting them to work and stabilizing our communities, but it will be a long-lasting impact for future generations.
Thank you. Greg.
The Stimulus Act. Do you remember Solyndra? We funneled tons of money to them, and they went out of business with our money. How about the depot downtown? It sits empty. They have yoga classes there once in a while. That was a major, major money drain. You know, if these people would come back into the city and see where their money is being wasted, they'd go back to Washington and find out this isn't working. The stimulus, we need to leave it up to the American people to spend their own money with their own checkbook. It's just absurd that the government can stand in the way and do the private business owner's job. We know how to spend money. We know how to save money. We know what's best for the customer because we got to fight for the customer. Congress doesn't have to fight for the customer. They just have to fight for their own pocketbook and their own spending priorities, which really aren't in the best interests of us. Leave it to the private sector to compete. Government is one of the largest monopolies, and we just can't compete with a monopoly. So we need to let the private sector spend the money in the best way that they see fit. We are shoppers. We know how to save money. We know where to buy the best and the most inexpensive products. We know how to contract with people and how to get the best deal for our dollar. Congress really doesn't have that discipline. They never have and they never will. You get me into Congress, that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to 30 years.
Stop.
I'm going to have a rebuttal on that.
That's fine.
Because I mentioned the Union Depot project, and it's something I'm very proud of. That has caused billions of dollars investment. Have you been down to Lower Town lately? Have you seen the bustle? Have you seen the activity? The Custom House, which is now 95% occupied with renters, a hotel going down in the bottom of it, all of that was off the tax rolls. And you know who took advantage of that opportunity to do it? It was a private business developer who saw an opportunity for a public-private partnership. And I'm very happy that Amtrak is coming into St. Paul. And I certainly hope we get high-speed rail, because I want to invest in today so that America and our Fortune 500 companies and the rest stay here into the future, so our children have a bright future here in the 4th District and all over Minnesota.
Greg, you got 45 seconds. Remember, I get moderator to
speak. The Lower Town has been subsidized. When you hear private-public partnership, or anything that has to do with partnership, it has everything to do with locking on to the taxpayers' money through tax increment financing. They overbuilt CHS Stadium. You would not believe the mechanical system that they have down there. It was triple the cost, because what they're doing is they're using what they call the water from the sinks, and they're reusing it for some of the irrigation. It's a smart system, but it's about 10 times the cost. But a lot of the development, or most of the development that happens downtown St. Paul, is through tax increment financing or some sort of a subsidy to the developer. Otherwise, a lot of these developers just would balk on any opportunities down there unless they're locked into some sort of a
Betty,
subsidy.
If you want 30 seconds, go for it.
Well, I stand by the work that happens when we reinvest in our communities. Whether it's Lower Town, whether it's in Arden Hills, the TCAP site, which is another thing that I worked on for many, many years. It sat abandoned, and now it's all being developed, and it's all going back onto the tax rolls for Ramsey County. It's a win for our schools, it's a win for our seniors, and it's a win for workers.
Susan, you've been waiting patiently to answer the question. You remember the question?
I think so.
Okay.
I believe that part of the problem is that manufacturing has been moved out of America, and that leaves very little opportunity. And so I believe our government has a responsibility to help small businesses so that they can provide services for their local communities. And then they need to be able to maintain their business long enough to become sustainable. So that's where our government could help small businesses. And of course, our government should support different jobs programs so that we can fix our roads and bridges. And if there's lots and lots of work out there, perhaps it just hasn't been done to this point. You know, that's something that should have been started a long time ago. Also, I believe that we can look at data, we can look at movement patterns, and that the government should invest in transportation, you know, projects, the Amtrak and light rail, in order to keep the money evolving, revolving with inside of communities. And I really think that's where the problem is you can't just, you know, build a bunch of buildings and expect people to go to work. There actually needs to be a job to be done. So we need to take advantages of the skills of the people in the communities and get the money revolving through that community. And through that, we can help fix communities and help them grow and cooperate.
Thank you. I'll begin the next question with Greg. Estimates project that by 2034, the Social Security Trust Fund for Retirement and Disability Obligations will be depleted. According to the estimates, incoming taxes will only be sufficient to pay 79% of promised benefits in 2034. What reforms, if any, do you recommend for Social Security?
Well, the money goes into a fund which is used by the Congress. The money isn't specifically being spent on the retirees. They have a lot of over-administration costs, and I think they do use some of the money for other projects other than just the retirement of the citizens that had paid into it. But other than that, I wouldn't really change much with the social security system. These people have worked a long, long time, and I would actually add to it and make sure that these people get paid the full amount that they actually put in. So if somebody passes away, their wife or their husband would get the rest of the money, even if they had been collecting on their own. So I don't think that if you don't have any heirs, it should just go to a cause for your beliefs or something like that. So,
okay. Thank you. Susan?
I believe the Social Security system is designed to take care of itself, and if the funds are being used, we need to replace those. I think I already mentioned that we could increase the income deduction cap in order to keep that solvent. We could also fund administrative services so we could look closely for incidences of fraud and abuse to try and administer our services better.
Thank you. Betty?
Well, I don't support any borrowing against the Social Security Trust Fund. Never have, and I never will. I think we can look at the payroll cap. That seems to have broad bipartisan support. I wish we could move forward in looking at that. But there's one thing I will not do, and I will not privatize Social Security. After the financial collapse, I don't know how many people called our office. Their houses were underwater. They watched their retirement savings and different financial instruments go flat based on the stock market. And the one thing that they said is, well, at least I know I have my Social Security. And so I think the three of us up here really agree tonight that Social Security might need some slight reforms and some enhancements, but it sounds like this is something that we've all found common ground that we know it's really important for people to be able to retire with dignity.
Thank you. I'll begin the next question with Susan. What, if any, changes would you make to the country's approach to immigration? Specifically, would you support a path to legalization or citizenship for those already in the country illegally?
Absolutely. We've got to create a pathway for those citizens that are in limbo. We've got to find humane deterrents for entering this country illegally. I really believe that the indigenous people of this world are really the only people that can complain about illegal immigrants. And our vetting process, although it may be slow, I believe it works properly to bring new citizens into this country. I believe the real question is our intention for humanitarian goals when we bring people in? Because I think we're sadly mistaken if we're trying to help other individuals. There are millions of people who are living in poverty. And we could never take them. And there's billions of people. We would never be able to help them here in America. So we also need to think about those alleged illegal immigrants that are being incarcerated in private prisons. That's inhumane. We've got to come up with humane ways of dealing with other humans that are just simply looking for a place to live.
Thank you. Betty.
Well, we need to look at pathways for legal citizenship. For the children who have come over here, some of them as young as several months to 2 years, this is the country that they know. They learned how to say the Pledge of Allegiance in our schools. They think of themselves as American citizens. And I was very proud when President Obama tried to move forward to protect those children who view themselves 100% Americans. And our business community needs good workers. Many of these students have excelled in school, they're ready to go to college, and they're ready to contribute back to the only country that they know and they love. People who serve in our military, they should have an immediate pathway forward once they're honorably discharged. So there's things we can work on. The business community, the faith community, and law enforcement, and many of us in Congress, thought at the end of President Bush's term, we were going to have a bill to vote on. We were going to put this question to rest so that we could focus on other things in our economy and moving America forward. But the bill never came to the floor. No one got the chance to vote because some of the people on the other side of the aisle just said enough. And we're not voting for any form of immigration reform. It's hurt our communities, it's hurt families, it's hurt our businesses, and it's hurt our way to move forward for those children who know no other country but the United States of America as their country.
Thank you. Greg.
Right now we need to enforce the rules and the regulations on immigration that we have now. That hasn't been done with the Obama administration and the Eric Holder, Loretta Lynch, Justice Department. We've been letting these people in, and we really haven't been doing our job as the President and the Justice Department. Customs agents down on the border are saying, our hands are tied. We need to just let these people go in. The court systems aren't really doing the balances and checks. We support, or Betty supports, sanctuary cities, and this is running wild. We have cities that basically allow these illegals to come in, and we got to stop that at the border. We need to have a strict support of the laws that we have right now. That's why they call it illegal. If you or I had to, if we have done something illegal, we would be in front of a judge trying our case. These people are not. They need to follow the steps. There's too many good Americans that immigrated here through the proper steps. It's just not right for these people to have to go through the long process to get here legally and have these people slipping through the cracks and coming through illegally and taking the jobs from the hardworking citizens of the United States.
Stop. Betty, would you like a one-minute rebuttal?
I certainly would. St. Paul's a sanctuary city. Our public prosecutors and our police department and many of our faith community support that. One of the reasons is women who find themselves trafficked, or the children that we're talking about find themselves preyed upon gang members. They can go to law enforcement, they can testify, and they can cooperate to make our community safer. Without being a sanctuary city, they just go farther and farther into the shadows. That puts them at risk, and it puts all of us at risk. So I'm very honored that I do represent a community and a city that stands up for victims and stands up for children.
45 seconds.
These people are taking our jobs. We can't go out and find a job nowadays that pays a decent salary because these people are coming in illegally. We go out and build our businesses and then we find out that there's somebody else doing the same thing and they're competing with us and they're not here legally. And then they put the onus on us employers that we have to have card checks or we have to have e-verify. What is that business of the employers to be doing the federal government's job. It's just wrong. We need to keep these people in the process line, which we have established, and you can get in here legally. What's the secret? What's the big secret of coming in here without being legitimate?
Betty, 30 seconds if you'd like, and I'll be in.
So let's talk about the people who, from the business community, the farmers who have come to my office saying, we need to fix this immigration system because we don't have people to work on our farms. People from California, the farmers there who come and say, we need people to make sure that we have safe, fresh produce. These are people who quite often are people who take jobs that we depend upon every single day of our life, and we don't even realize what a difference they're making.
Thank you. I could have made a whole forum out of this, obviously, this topic. Betty, I'll begin the next question with you. The divisive nature that seems to permeate the culture of D.C. often leaves Congress stuck in gridlock. What concerns you most about our government's inability to legislate in a way that most Americans consider ineffective, and is there a solution?
Well, on the Appropriations Committee, we work really hard across the aisle, and it's one of the few committees that still has a lot of civility and still a lot of we-can-do-it attitude. But then when we bring the bills to the floor of the House, and they're not perfect bills, and I'm happy to get them to a conference committee and see if we can approve them, the Republican Party, this is widely reported, the Republican Party has a problem with the Freedom Caucus and the Tea Party folks within their party, and they bring down their own bills. They brought down a perfectly good energy and water bill, which would have made more jobs available and helped with our infrastructure and helped California and with some water problems and rebuilt water infrastructure. But they brought it down because of a simple amendment that said, if you're a federal contractor, you cannot discriminate against people who love people of the same sex. They brought the bill down based over that. Jobs, opportunity, work that needs to be done. We can do better than that in the Congress of the United States, and we should, and I'll continue to work with my fellow appropriators on the other side of the aisle to bring bills to the floor and hopefully pass them.
Thank you. Greg.
The old saying, we can do better, we can do better. I think it's public, it's special interest groups and lobbyists that are paying these people off, like Wells Fargo. She got $5,000 recently from Wells Fargo, and they were grilling the CEO in front of Congress very recently. So it's just these politicians are bought and paid for. They're going to do what they believe is in the better interests of their own wallets, their own pockets, and that's what they're sold. They're bought and paid for by the special interests. That's what I'm going to do. I'm going to go there, and I'm not going to be influenced by the money or by the special interests or the lobbyists. I'm going to go there and fight for us, all of our money, and I'm going to do what is in the best interest of the citizens of the 4th District and the citizens of the whole of the United States. People aren't going to question that when I go to Congress and explain that to the rest of these people that are being paid off by the special interests and, you know, this gridlock. That's a bunch of crap, because what's going on is they're fighting over turf. They're fighting over special interests here, special interests there. If they really were singing the song that is in the best interest of us, the American people, they're lost in D.C. They're in their own little world. They're so isolated from reality. I see this every day.
Okay, Betty, you're getting 1 minute, and that will be, we're moving on to Susan on the question. We're running out of time in the forum, so go ahead.
Well, first and foremost, we need to change our campaign finance system. It doesn't work for the American public, and I'm on lots of bills to do that. I'm ready to do it. I worked on the public finance system here in Minnesota. A model like that would be welcome to me, but we need to change our campaign finance system. The Wells Fargo employees, it was an employee PAC. The bank tellers that work in the banks, the people who do the day-to-day operations for the bank, I am proud to have the employees' support. The men and women who, like myself, when I worked at First Banks, make a decision to put into a PAC. They make the decision who the funds go to. And if It has nothing to do with me being in the interest of the big banks. I'll tell you, they weren't happy. They haven't been happy with any of my votes, especially the Dodd-Frank vote. But I'm proud to have the support of the working men and women here in the 4th Congressional District.
Susan?
I believe that, in my understanding, the leader, the president, would set the agenda. And then Congress, working below the president, would work on all the alternatives to try and meet the president's agenda. And quite often what we have is a disconnect between the agenda and the alternatives, and a lot of stuff happens, but very little work gets done. I believe that there is a sentiment in the Republican Party that government is a waste of time and a waste of money, and then they go about not funding agencies so they can turn around and say, see, government doesn't work. And it's a sabotage. I believe the solution would be to vote for third-party candidates. Right now, your alternatives are Democratic and Republican. Well, I'm your third-party candidate. I'm offering you an alternative. And if we can get enough people to start running for office, we can maybe replace some of the representatives that we have, and then we could go about real campaign finance. We can talk about campaign finance, but I'm not sure how many people in office today are going to change campaign finance.
Greg, would you like 30 seconds to address the Republican statement?
Well, it's a little bit absurd to be hearing that. I think it's an individual basis. I mean, we've got these two major parties, whether or not we all have opinions of one party or the other. I think it's the individual with the title behind that person that's going to be bringing this voice forward. In my opinion, I'm going to go there without that label on my back, and I'm going to try to discourage that label of being this party
Stop.
Or that party.
Thanks. And you're going on to the next question. Evaluate current U.S. tax structure and policy. What, if anything, would you change?
Tax structure? Where do I start?
Minute and a half. Start quickly.
Oh, my God. The death tax, we have all kinds of taxes. It's unbelievable. I pay my bills. I have a checkbook. I've been studying the bills that I have to pay. We have so many agencies that are attached to the money that I pay. We have so many different layers of our government that is taxing us to death. It is just absurd that all of us are subjected to that. Most people really don't analyze what they're paying for when it comes to a bill or property taxes or when someone dies. For instance, Prince, what a tragic loss for Minnesota. The biggest beneficiary to Prince's death is the federal and the state government. That's absurd. This money should go to their families. The government never earned that money. So I don't know why they should get that by default, because the loss of a family member or the loss of somebody, they need to steal that money from that family and use it wastefully. I just look at the wasteful things the government does, and I just started getting a little disappointed, a little mad, because of I work really, really hard. And the harder I work, the more my government gets paid. That's just, it just really bothers me a lot, because we have such an inefficient government. If government had to compete, if we took and threw all of the agencies.
Stop. Susan?
I believe that our systems are very complicated, and there's quite a bit of paperwork and a minutia of details. And I believe that our government representatives actually have a responsibility to try and minimize the confusion. And as opposed to every year adding to the layers and layers, the web the intricate mess between local, state, and federal government, they have a responsibility to try and minimize that. Again, I believe that if we could fund the agency properly and fund administration so that we can minimize fraud and abuse of the system, and try and create tax systems that are more fair and that are easier to understand and easier to use, and that would cut a lot of waste.
Thank you. And Betty?
Well, we could start with the oil companies. They don't need a tax break. There's lots of things in the tax code that can be eliminated. And we had a bipartisan group of folks coming around. In fact, they came here to the Twin Cities. It was a Democratic senator from Montana, Senator Baucus, and Dave Camp from Michigan, a Republican, and they had a whole suggestion of ideas to take up. They begged the Congress to have hearings on their bill, and they didn't do it. But I'm just kind of baffled about what has happened with the discussion on taxes. I'm all for helping middle-class families and helping our businesses and our entrepreneurs and our startup businesses. But when I read in the paper what Donald Trump paid in taxes, there's something wrong with the tax system because it's skewed to benefit the very, very wealthy at the top, and the rest of us are supporting that. And that needs to change. Do we need tax reform? We sure do. Big companies don't need tax perks anymore, and Donald Trump, I think, needs not to be in a position where he doesn't pay taxes for going on close to what, I'll round up, 20 years?
Thank you. I believe this is, what do you, why?
Donald Trump is a Republican.
Oh, well, even I'm going to have to say no to this.
You're kidding.
No.
Well, okay.
I mean, you got. I said indirectly or directly, and I've done these forums enough to know when we're pulling in extra, and I don't think so. Okay, he's on the ballot alone, individually. It's not Ryan and Trump. Okay.
That's okay.
He can bring it up in closing. I'm not going to, just so you know, I'm the moderator here, okay? So I'll make the decision on the discretion. I've done this enough years. Susan, you got the lab. We got one question left, and I do want to get it in. Gun control continues to be discussed frequently, but not a lot has changed one way or another in recent years. What is your stance on gun control? Do the laws need to be changed or enforced differently?
I feel very strongly about gun control. Yes, we do need stricter gun control laws. However, I have great concerns with who would control our guns. If that would be our government, I don't think our government has a very good track record of controlling much of anything. So that is a tough issue. Yes. We need gun control measures.
Yeah, and I also want to remind people that they can use their time on the questions if there are things that they want to pick up and continue on. Next person on that will be Betty on gun control.
We've asked for a vote on the House floor. We know we have enough votes to pass it. It says simply, if you can't fly, you can't buy an assault weapon. Makes a lot of sense to me. If you're too dangerous to fly on an airplane, why should you be able to go into a gun store and purchase unlimited quantities of guns? We need a vote on that bill. America, overwhelmingly, the public supports it. And the assault weapons ban was allowed to just disappear without real input from the American people how they feel about it. So we have now people who are out, can out gun the police departments. The very people that we asked to put their lives on the line are facing weapons that they don't even have for protecting themselves. So there's some common sense gun safety reform that can happen, and the American people would like to at least see Congress take a vote on it so they know where people stand one way or the other.
Thank you. Greg.
Second Amendment. It's right after the first. If we're going to start putting controls on the Second Amendment, we should start putting controls on the First Amendment. It's absurd that we are even considering that. This no-fly list, if those people can't fly in a plane, I don't want them in society. They should be locked up. That's kind of the way I believe it should be. My father died of a gun. He was murdered at our store in 1984. If he had a gun, he would have been able to protect himself. They didn't have that law, the concealed carry, back then. I believe that we should probably get back to the old days and start arming America so we can protect ourselves, because the police and the law enforcement are crime scene investigators. They get there usually too late, and the crime has been already committed. Minneapolis, last night, we had this spree of gunshots last night, probably by illegal ownership of a gun, by illegal people that shouldn't even be owning guns. It's the court systems that are releasing these people early. It's the liberal judges that don't believe that the sentences should be that harsh. So I'm a firm believer in the Second Amendment, and it shouldn't be, rules should not be hacked up. We shouldn't hack up the Second Amendment. It's there for a reason. And we should just be proud that we have it, and we should have it.
Thank you. I have 1.5 minutes to offer for closing. Feel free to tidy up anything anyone has said, and I will begin begins with Betty McCollum.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Thank you, Margot, Mr. Ryan, Ms. Sennett. Thank you. I enjoyed this opportunity to be together here this evening. And I want to thank the Stillwater Gazette again for hosting this candidate forum. I want to extend my deep appreciation to the residents of both Ramsey and Washington County who have given me the opportunity, a true privilege, to serve them in the United States House of Representatives. My job in Congress is to work for you and to make the federal government work for all of Minnesota families. We have two beautiful rivers in this district, the St. Croix and the Mississippi River. And my work as the lead Democrat on the Interior House Appropriations Committee means I have direct responsibility to protect and cherish these very, very special scenic rivers and working rivers in our district. But this election's going to be about meeting the needs of the 4th District families. It means working on jobs, infrastructure, good schools, and a clean environment. It's about security for America here at home and for our nation in a very dangerous world. Building a better, stronger America, you need to know that I think it needs to start with my commitment to you to have more civility in Congress. I'm asking the 4th District for their voters, Democrat, Republican, and Independent. I'll keep working hard for you, and I will always put our families in Minnesota first. Thank you.
Thank you. And Greg?
Well, we've been hearing the same story for 30 years. Betty's been a 30-year politician, and I think the 4th District is a little tired of it. She's been representing us in Congress for the last 16 years, and she's begging for two more years. This is a career politician, and we're tired of it. Business owner for 32 years, I've seen nothing but degradation and growing government continue since I was the owner and operator of our small company in St. Paul. We have experienced smaller companies getting more pressure from our government, and it's much more difficult than ever before. Since her tenure began in North St. Paul, I have been running a business 2 years to when she started in politics. And for the last 32 years, our government has been taking more of the piece of pie from us citizens individually and as business owners. Small businesses are close to 70% of the working people out there take away the government. Right now, Minnesota is the largest employer. State of Minnesota is the largest employer in Minnesota, and they just overcame. So it's a growth of government, our federal government. We need to put the departments in the state's hands. We don't need the federal government to be dealing with the education department in Minnesota. The transportation department can be dealt with in St. Paul.
Thank you. Susan, you have the final closing.
Thank you. I also want to thank you for this opportunity for me to speak to my community. You know, Minnesota isn't like Colorado. You're never going to see a question on the ballot asking if we should be able to consume cannabis for our own personal use. We're a non-initiative state, and we don't have the ability to petition to have a question on the ballot. So I had to go about petitioning to get myself on the ballot to run on this very important issue. I'm concerned about the environment. I'm very concerned about our health care. I'm very concerned about the future that we leave for our children. Very concerned about the crime and the violence that's created by the corruption of the war on drugs. There are major issues that we need to deal with. I should not be in this situation where we have to ask for our medicine or ask for us to help save the environment, provide this wonderful industrial product. It's fiction that marijuana should be a Schedule I drug. It is fiction that hemp is the same as marijuana. Thank you so much for giving me the opportunity to speak to you about this very important issue that touches every aspect of our life. This is not a joke.
Thank you, Susan. Thank you all three for joining us today. Thank you for coming.
Thank you.
And thank you for watching. There are going to be several replays of this on Valley Access Channels 15 and 16. On behalf of the Stillwater Gazette and Managing Editor Jonathan Young, Forum Organizer Beth Johnson, Timekeeper Paige Johnson, and me, thank you.